And that's such a beautiful story. It's amazing the way that we have seen God work. And while that's not everybody's story, whatever chapter you find yourself in today, our hope is that you'd be encouraged in your faith. And it was 8 years ago that that Reed gave me this little book. It's called Praying Circles Around Your Children. It's by Mark Batterson. And it's about 100 pages, and it's short. Some of you are like, that sounds like a great book. Like, you had me at 100 pages. But it's a short read, and it's a powerful idea. And Mark Batterson, he writes about how it makes a difference for us to pray circles around our kids. Praying circles around them means we pray with consistency and intentionality and perseverance. And he teases out this idea that praying circles around our marriages, around our work, about our dreams, around our future, when we pray circles, it changes things. And praying circles is not a new idea. It goes back thousands of years to something that happened, the oldest city on the earth. When God's people faced a challenge and they faced impossible circumstances, God told them, I want you to walk in circles. Have you ever faced impossible circumstances? Have you ever faced a situation where you thought it seemed impossible, where you were at the end of yourself? Maybe that's where you feel like you're at right now, man, whether at work or in business or in marriage, maybe with one of your kids. Maybe there's a financial crisis that's going on, a situation, maybe a situation with a family member, or maybe there's something that you're going through that when you look at it, when you think about it, you think that's never gonna change. Maybe it's a habit or an addiction, or you start to think it's always gonna be this way. It just feels impossible. And today we're gonna talk about, what do you do when you face impossible circumstances in your life? When you're up against the battles that just seem bigger than you. Now to get there, we're in our final week of battles and blessings. And we're looking at Joshua, and we're looking at Joshua chapter 6. Now, this series has been speaking to the reality that we've all got battles and blessings going on in our lives. So no matter how big your battles, there's always something to be grateful for. There's always a blessing. And no matter how blessed you are, there's always something to improve. Battles and blessings. Both of these things going on simultaneously. And that's where we are in life right now. As the other day, I was talking with a friend of mine, and he's newly married, and he's got this great job, and he works from home, and he's got no kids yet. And he's like, you know what? This quarantine has been the most restful and refreshing time of my life. And then I talked to other people who have lost their jobs and taking pay cuts, and marriages are struggling, and a house full of kids dealing with levels of loneliness and anxiety and depression like they've never known. And the truth is, we all have had very different experiences of the past 6 weeks. So we can't assume that other people have had our experience, but where we've been blessed, we can ask ourselves, how can I be a blessing to others? Like Scott. When I was preparing this message, I got an email from him, and I want to read it to you. He says, my name is Scott, and I started attending Crosspoint 2 years ago at a time when I was at the lowest point I'd ever been and had nowhere to turn. And since that day, God has done an amazing work in me that I've never felt I deserved. I ended up getting married, and my wife and I strengthened our relationship, and I gave my life to the Lord. And I've been living sober for almost a year now. But back to why I'm reaching out. Today, I received a stimulus check in the mail from the government that I was not expecting to get. My wife and I have remained fully employed in the pandemic. And now that I have it, I want to do something good with it. I wanted to see if I could help a family that is struggling right now. Come on, isn't that good? God got a hold of Scott's life and he changed him. And now Scott's like, God's blessed me. Now I want to be a blessing to somebody else. I want to bless somebody else in their battle. So we helped connect Scott up with a single mom who was furloughed from her job, and he was able to pay her mortgage for the month. Isn't that good? Like, we all have battles and we all have blessings. But listen, we can't wait until we have a battle-free life to be a blessing to other people, because there's no such thing as a battle-free life. Like, we just look at the blessings we have and say, how can I be a blessing to others with the blessings that I've received? Now in Deuteronomy chapter 8, I want you to see what Moses tells the nation of Israel. He has a conversation with the nation of Israel, and he's telling them, he lets them know that the land that we're going to is good. That God has a land for us. He has a land for us that's a blessing. He says, for the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks and streams and deep springs gushing out of the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates and olive oil and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. What Moses is doing is he's painting a picture of the promised land. He's giving them a vision. Now remember, they're in the wilderness, and he's giving them a vision that will continue to keep them going. See, hope is what pulls us into the future. And next week, we're going to start a brand new series. We're going to talk about hope. We're going to talk about vision. It's going to be called Above and Beyond. And I believe that God wants to use this series to help lift us up and give us power and perspective to have vision in our lives, to see that he can do exceedingly more than what we can ask or imagine. And God gives them vision. And he says, the land is good. He says, it's going to be a blessing, but you're going to have battles to fight. That's why he told Joshua, he said, be strong and courageous because I'm with you. I'm with you wherever you go. Joshua, there are going to be blessings, but the greatest blessing is knowing that I'm with you. Like, if you've put your trust in Jesus, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the living God lives in you. Listen, that is the blessing of life. It's the blessing in life. It's the blessing of life that I wouldn't trade anything in this world for, to know that God is with me and you can know that God is with you. If you've put your trust in Jesus, the blessing is that his Spirit lives in you. And Joshua needs the courage that comes from that because he's leading 1 million people into the promised land. And the Jordan River is what stands in between them and the land that God's promised. And remember, it's at flood stage, and he's got to figure out, how do you get all these people over there? How do you get the nation across? And it seems impossible, but impossibility is not in God's vocabulary. And listen, sometimes God will, he'll engineer seemingly impossible circumstances in our lives to set things up for him to get greater glory from our lives, because God's into sharing a lot of things, but glory's not one of them. And Joshua seeks the Lord. And God does something amazing. He parts the water, and the nation of Israel, the entire nation, walks through on dry ground. Just as God was with Moses, God said, I'll be with you. And God parted the Red Sea for Moses, and he parts the Jordan for Joshua. And he said, I don't want you to forget this. So remember, he had Joshua get 12 men on each one from each tribe and grab 12 stones and stack 12 stones as a reminder. At Gilgal, God said, whenever you look at those stones, I want you to remember, and I want your children to remember, and tell your children's children. And they ask, what are those stones about? You tell them. Tell them that I got you across. Tell them about the rescuing hand of God. Tell them that God saved you and that he delivered you and that he made a way for you. And Joshua climbed up on those stones with the nation of Israel gathered around. And he said, God, you are a waymaker. You were a miracle worker. You were a promise keeper, a light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. And that is where the song Waymaker came from. It's where it was written. I'm just kidding. I made that up. It was too much fun. but I'm sure Joshua, like, he would have loved that song, right? Because he lived that truth. Like, he saw God make a way for him. And just like we can see God make a way for us. But Joshua would need that experience of God making a way, because like 5 miles after the Jordan River, after the crossing, Israel faced their first battle in the Promised Land. They faced Jericho. Now, a year ago, we went with our family to the Holy Land, and we visited the ruins of Jericho, and it was amazing to climb around on the ruins with that city, like with my kids, and felt like Indiana Jones, you know. And I was going through that and reading through some of the archaeological study over the past century. And through that, we're able to have a pretty good idea of what Jericho was like back then. It's believed to be the oldest city in the world. Now, when they crossed over the river, they would have seen it because it sat up on a hill. And so it was the preeminent stronghold of the Canaanites. It would have been terrifying to them, because this generation had never seen a city like this before. They'd never seen a fortified city with walls. Now remember, they grew up in the wilderness, and so they hadn't seen a skyline like this. They hadn't seen walls like this. And the closer they got to Jericho, the bigger the walls seemed, and the more insignificant and the more impossible it felt. There were actually two walls around Jericho. The first one was about like 15 feet high. It's about as tall as the wall behind me. And it's about 6 feet thick. So a little shorter than me. I'm just kidding. All right. Thanks for that laugh, the little courtesy laugh there in your living room. But then there was another wall that was behind it. So the wall that was behind it was about twice as tall. And the city wasn't huge. It was about 6 acres, but the walls were high. And the Israelites, they were facing something they never faced before. It seemed impossible, which has me thinking, what's your Jericho? Like, what's the thing in your life that you're looking at right now? And the more you look at it, the more impossible it feels. The more you study it, the more fear grows in your heart. And you've measured the walls and you've counted the stones and you've run the numbers and you just can't see, like you can't see how it's gonna work. What do you do with impossibility? What do you do when the battle is bigger than you? And from Joshua chapter 6, I wanna give you 5 key principles to take with you into the battle. Now, I cheated because it's not just from Joshua chapter 6. We're gonna have to rewind the tape and go back to the end of chapter 5. And I want you to look there with me. If you've got a Bible, you can follow along. Joshua chapter 5, we'll pick up in verse 13. It says, "Now when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up and he saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. And Joshua went up to him and asked, 'Are you for us or for our enemies?' 'Neither,' he replied, 'but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come.' And then Joshua fell face down to the ground in reverence, and he asked him, 'What message does my Lord have for his servant?' And the commander of the Lord's army replied, 'Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy.' And Joshua did so." Now, Joshua has an encounter with God. And this is where the battle of Jericho is won. Because before the walls fell, Joshua had to fall on his face. See, at first, Joshua doesn't realize who he's talking to. He's like, "Are you with us or are you with them? Are you on our side or are you on their side? Are you with our political party or are you with theirs?" And God says, "Neither." I says, I don't fit in your boxes. The question is not, am I on your side? The question God's asking is, are you on my side? Will you surrender to me? Listen, when you face impossible circumstances, the first thing you must do, the first thing I've got to do is we've got to surrender to God. Take off our sandals. It's holy ground. And it's embracing this truth that I'm not in charge and I'm not in control. It's embracing the truth that I'm not in charge and I'm not in control. Joshua was in charge of the army, but God was in charge of Joshua. He needed to settle this before he went into battle. Remember what Scott said in his email? He said, "I gave my life to the Lord." That's where victory begins. That's where victory for his sobriety begins. It begins in that place of saying, "I give my life to the Lord. I surrender. I'm giving back to God what is rightfully his. I'm surrendering it to him." And if there's one thing that this pandemic has taught us, it's that we're not in control. Like, there's only one thing. I mean, think about it. There's only one thing that you can control. You know what that is? It's you on a good day. And they call it self-control. And Galatians 5 tells us that it's a fruit of the Spirit, which means it's a byproduct of God's Spirit living in us. And so the only way that we have self-control is when we put God in charge of our life and say, "God, I'm depending on you to run the show. Like, I'm not in charge of me anymore. I'm signing over the rights to my life. I'm giving my life to you." And Joshua takes off his sandals as a sign of a way to say, God, I'm giving my life to you." And he gets on his face saying, "God, I report to you now." Now, I wonder if Joshua didn't need this moment after crossing over the Jordan. It said that after they crossed the Jordan, it's Joshua 4:14 says that on that day that God exalted Joshua in sight of the entire nation of Israel. And like they stood in awe of him in the same way that they stood in awe of Moses. And when God exalts you and he blesses you, it's your responsibility to humble yourself, to continue to get on your face in dependence to him. And people might put you on a pedestal at times. What do you do when they put you on a pedestal? You climb off. You climb off the pedestal and get on your face before God. Because God wants to bless you more, but he can't bless pride. 1 Peter chapter 5 says, "God oppresses the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God so he can exalt you in due time." See, pride says, "I've got this." But humility says, "God, I depend on you. I'm not in charge, you're in charge. I'm not in control, you're in control." That's surrender. And the second thing after surrender is to define the problem. What's the battle you're facing? Max DePree said the first responsibility of a leader is to define reality. What that means is you got to face a challenge. You got to name your Jericho. In Luke 18, it tells us that Jesus was walking down the street, and as he was passing by, a blind man named Bartimaeus just yelled out, and he said, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus looks at him, and he says, "What do you want me to do for you?" Which seems a little odd, all right? It seems odd for Jesus to ask the question of a blind man, "What do you want me to do for you?" I mean, you're Jesus. Like, don't you know what he wants? I mean, he's blind, but Jesus still asked him. Why? Because Jesus wanted to know, Bartimaeus, do you know what you want? Because it takes faith to name it. It takes faith to ask. It takes faith to face your Jericho. And maybe your Jericho is the fear about the future. Maybe it's a private world addiction that consumes your life. Maybe there's a relationship that's turned sideways and there's bitterness or there's unforgiveness that's just draining you. Maybe there's an attitude of where you're believing a lie about yourself or about your body or about your worth. It just keeps you from joy. It keeps you from peace. It keeps you from rest. Maybe there's some guilt and shame about some stuff that's in your past. And Jesus asks the question, what do you want? Maybe what you need is a blank sheet of paper in that question. The one who can make blind eyes see in the physical can give us eyes to see the Jericho in our own life. And Joshua, he stared at his Jericho. And look what happens in chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse 1 says, "Now the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites, and no one went out and no one came in." So there was an official stay-at-home order in place. Too soon? Maybe. I'm sorry. "Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I've delivered Jericho into your hands along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men and do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. And on the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. And when you hear them sounding a long blast on the trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout, and then the wall of the city will collapse and the army will go up, everyone straight in." First, we surrender. Then second, we define reality. And then we ask God for his plans. We ask God, what do you want me to do? Now, when it comes to plans, when it comes to facing our Jericho, a lot of times we don't even ask for God's plans. We just come up with our plans, we work our plans, and we do it without him. I wonder how many times we keep running into walls because we're doing our plans. And then there are other times we come up with plans and then we pray, God, would you bless my plans? But then the third option is to pray and wait on God to give his plans and to do what he wants. And God gives Joshua a very specific plan. And it's an odd plan, isn't it? I mean, can you imagine just being Joshua? Can you imagine being Joshua and going, okay, God, let me get this right. So you want us to walk around the city one time every day, and you want us to do that for 6 days, and you want us to be silent, not say anything. And then on the 7th day, you want us to march around 7 times and then blow the trumpets. And then when we shout, the walls are going to fall. God, that's it. That's the plan. Can you imagine being Joshua and giving that plan to the 40,000 soldiers? Okay, guys, here's what we're going to do. You ready? And can you imagine giving that plan? Can you imagine? Like, Joshua knew that there would be people who didn't agree with the plans that God gave him. Listen, your job is not to please everyone. Your job is to honor God and to please God. And sometimes God's going to ask you to do things that just don't make sense, like walking in circles, like praying in circles, like holding up your hands in worship, like getting on your face in prayer, like picking up the phone and calling somebody you haven't talked to in 14 years to ask for forgiveness. Like forgiving somebody else who hurt you. Like going back and saying you're sorry or being generous to a stranger. Like sometimes God will ask us to do things that are odd and that are uncomfortable, but he gives us his peace. And so we follow the plan that God gives us. But until we know the specifics of that plan, let me give you a plan that works. Walk and pray. If there's nothing else that we've learned during this pandemic, during this quarantine, is that we've learned how to walk now, right? Walk around the neighborhood. Like, I just encourage you, add prayer to the walking. Pray circles around the neighborhood. Pray circles around your kids. Pray circles around schools. Pray circles around your business. Pray circles around your house. Pray circles around your family. Pray circles around your Jericho. You can pray something like this: God, you're in charge. You're in control. And I surrender everything and everyone to you. I give you my Jericho. I ask you to tear down the walls. Give me the faith to trust you and the courage to do what you say. The battle belongs to you. Just something like that. If you want to whittle it down, a great prayer that I learned from John Eldridge that I read in a book was, I surrender everything and everyone to you. Just keep praying that. Surrender. Just do what the Israelites did. We walk and we pray. And then the last thing is, don't give up. And Mark Batterson said, if the Israelites, if they would have stopped circling Jericho on day 6, they would have forfeited the miracle one day before it happened. So what if your miracle is just one more day away? Don't give up. And sometimes faithfulness is just the faith to get out of bed. Sometimes faithfulness is just the faith to just keep taking one more step. And it's in that repetition, in doing the next day, that's where faith shows up. And repetition is saying, God, my trust is in you. I mean, where else am I gonna go? Who else am I gonna turn to? God, who else do I have but you? I trust in you. And maybe it's a dark night right now, but just keep going. And maybe you feel alone, reach out for help. Maybe the walls seem real big and you feel real small, keep walking and know that you're not alone, that God is with you. And listen, we're with you too. In fact, maybe right now you'd like to have somebody pray with you about your situation. And we'd love to do that. In fact, we got a team of people who right now are here to pray with you. In fact, you can reach out and you can text us, the number on the screen. Or there's gonna be in the chat, there'll be information about how you can reach out. We would love to pray with you. And just as real as I walked on those ruins in Jericho, there are ruins of things in my past that are now on the ground. Walls that I thought would never fall. Situations that have turned. There are breakthroughs that have happened. There are relationships that have been restored. And not all of them can I like look back and I can't circle a date on the calendar and say, that's the date that everything changed. But I can take you to the ruins. I can say those things don't have power over me like they once did. And it didn't happen because I'm good or because I'm strong. It happened because he is. I just kept walking and trusting and surrendering and holding to the truth of his promises and letting go of my false premises. And do you know what one of those false premises was? This idea that I believe that, you know what, I'll never be free. That this will always be a stronghold in my life. And as long as I believed that, the enemy had me. But one day I got enough faith to believe, you know what? Jesus died for my freedom. I don't have to go down that road anymore. And something changed. And the walls began to fall. And I believe the same can be true for you. So what do when we face impossible circumstances? We surrender to God. We define the problem. We get real about the problem. And then we ask God for his plans, and then we follow his plans. And we don't give up. But it all starts with surrender. And maybe you're like Scott. Maybe you want change in your life. You just don't know how to begin it. Maybe you want to give your life to God like he did. I'd love to lead you in a prayer. I'd love to help you do that. And so I want to lead you in a prayer that you can make your own. And then if you pray it with me, I'd invite you to just let us know by texting the word life to 615-270-2428. I'm telling you, as a church, we'd love to encourage you and help you take your next steps in your faith walk. But today, if you want to follow Jesus and receive the life that he has for you, I'd invite you to pray something like this. Would you bow your head and pray with me? Father, thank you for loving me. And thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. Today, I surrender my life to you. This is holy ground. I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want to follow you here on earth and spend forever with you in heaven. So I receive your forgiveness. I receive your grace. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. That's incredible. Listen, if you made that your prayer today, you've just received the greatest blessing in this life, the blessing of God's presence with you always, and you have a blessing that's bigger in any battle that you might face.